and welcome to Zero Pucks Given, the ice hockey podcast for Chelmsford Chieftains fans. This is episode 19 and it is super jam-packed. We've got a match report on the Chieftains' road trip to Milton Keynes, results from the Cobras and the Academy, results from the rest of the NIHL1, and we've got three guests. Firstly, I'll be joined by Sam Callahan, the local lad who shot to stardom on the X Factor a few years back and is now a regular at the Riverside to see his local ice hockey team. I'll also be joined by supremely experienced former hockey player, now successful podcast host, Nicky Watt from 4000 and Counting, discussing his hockey career and his journey into the world of podcasting. And finally, we'll be joined by one of the newest Chieftains. This local lad come through the ranks at Romford and ended up in the black and gold at the top table with the Chieftains. And this weekend got his first goal as well. Do you know who he is? Yes, it's Richie Pickering. But let's get started at Planet Ice Milton Keynes as the Chieftains face the Thunder. Another one-game weekend for the Chieftains, this time in Milton Keynes. Anthony Leone took to the bench again. Check was in the pipes with Tassadri minding the nets for the under-18s this weekend, and there was a long-awaited return to the D-line for Casey Wilson. On the other bench, there was another familiar face, former ZPG guest and Chieftains captain Julian Smith, who did mention he'd been training with them occasionally, and their recent results would indicate a need for numbers and experience. So great to see Jules on the ice again, even if for another team. It was a fairly strong start by the Chieftains, pushing MK back into their defensive zone, and on 8.05 the onslaught started. Cam Bartlett with a nice close range finish from down the Chieftains' left. 55 seconds later, TJ Fillery calmly knocked home after a bit of a goalmouth scramble, making it 2-0 on 9 flat. On 10.53, Cam got his second after Grant intercepted an MK attack, fed Cam on the odd man rush, and he smashed top shelf from the right circle. 12 seconds after the restart, Fillery got his second again, a great close-range finish after some bullish play from the Chieftains. On 14.30, Grant Bartlett got in the action, taking the puck down the left side and shooting home via what looked like a painful defensive deflection. On 15.16, it was 6 after more neat work from the attacking lines had Ollie Baldock fed in the slot and he finished nicely. Straight after the restart, Kieran Rayner won the duel and skated the puck down hard, swooping across the crease from the right and tucking past Bradfield, who was then pulled and replaced by Graziano. 7-0 at the end of the first, 25 shots for the Chieftains in that first period. Into the second, then it started in much the same vein, as on just 34 seconds, Grant Bartlett and Pentecost combined for Cam Bartlett to take his hat-trick from a tight angle. Ross Clark then took a 2-minute penalty for slashing, which special teams duly killed, before our number 9 made it 9 and smashed in on 27-10. Double figures was achieved on 29-30 as Cam Bartlett swooped down the left across the circle and finished top shelf for his fourth of the evening. A couple of minutes later, in a real defensive lapse from the home side, allowed a turnover behind the net as Cam Bartlett found Richie Pickering all alone in the slot and he finished with aplomb, 11-0 on 35-25. Matt Turner took a 2-minute penalty for hooking, but the Chieftains killed the penalty, and shortly after returning to full strength, Grant Bartlett got his hat-trick on 38.06. The second finished 12-0. Into the third, and it was the home side who drew blood first, as on 42.01, Conor Douche finished well from close range after Harris found him from the inside right. The home side desperately defending their zone to keep the score down if they can, left the Chieftains attacking lines looking like they were playing offensive special teams. And on 51-34, with everyone holding their positions and their markers, Grant Bartlett skated around the block to smash home with a little help from goalkeeper Graziano on 51-34. The home side had a small period of 5-on-3 after Salisbury and Hitchings took two each for holding and slashing, but didn't take the power play chance. And when former Chieftains captain Julian Smith took two for hooking on 56-14, the Chiefs scored on their only power play of the night as Cam Bartlett hit his fifth in typical style slapshot from the left circle. A man of the match for Ollie Baldock, Graziano taking the honours for Milton Keynes, and a good week of training ahead before a double-header weekend as we have a rare Saturday home game on the 25th where Slough Jets are the visitors, before heading to Invicta for the final time in the league on Sunday the 26th, and that is truly the last dress rehearsal for the Britain Cup final, which has now been confirmed as the final weekend of the season before the playoffs. Saturday, March the 25th, Planet Ice Gillingham. Sunday, March 26th at Riverside Ice. Remember, season ticket holders will need to purchase tickets for the game. I believe they may well be available now, but best to search online and make sure you get yours before they're all gone. Other results in the NIHL 1 South. On Saturday, the Solent Devils beat Raiders 7-1 down at Planet Ice in Gosport, and Streatham got a shutout at the Hangar as they beat Slough Jets 8-0. In the NIHL 1 South, on Sunday, in addition to Milton Keynes 1, Chelmsford Chieftains 14, the Raiders went to overtime with the Slough Jets, and the Jets took it 2-1. And the Oxford City Stars had an incredible victory as they beat our cup final opponents in Invicta Dynamos by 7-2 at the Oxbens. Before the Academy results, a congratulations to all the girls who took part in the weekend's IIHF Global Girls Game events, especially to Academy players Kira, Connie, Ava, Sunny, Sophia and Zanti. And also the England Peewee team have been crushing it in Quebec, especially Chelmsford lad Ruben Terry. I'll be going up to training soon to catch up with the young man and discuss his experience out in Canada. The rest of the Academy then, the under-10s took two teams to Cambridge and performances were brilliant from all. The under-12s had a one-day tournament and finished third with four under-10s playing up. The under-16 Tomahawks got an 11-1 win against Basingstoke and had six different scorers amongst their goals. The under-16s Rattlesnakes got a 7-4 victory at home to Slough Icebees. The under-18s Mohawks went to Streatham, a good strength under-18 side to face last year's national champs, and a goalless first period and most of the second until Streatham took the lead on 36-58 through Highland. Quick response from the Mohawks as Ben Powell assisted Reese King to score on 38-55. However, in the third, goals from Lane on 43-12 and Ratcliffe on 53-45 saw the London side run out 3-1 victors. Over in the ladies' game, the Chelmsford Cobras unfortunately had a 12-0 defeat at home to Sheffield. So one to forget for the ladies there. So with the rest of the results now, we're going to get to our guests for this week. We're going to start with a young man who burst to stardom a few years ago as he was a finalist on the X Factor. He's a local lad and he now comes to watch the Chelmsford Chieftains. I believe he's got a little connection with our captain and that's what sort of got him into it. We're going to have a chat with Sam Callahan.
I don't have answers. I can't answer that. I used to sit and dream what I grew up to be. Now
Sam Callahan, how are you doing, fella?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm really well, mate. Thanks for joining me this evening.
It's all right. Thanks for having me on.
So, I saw you at the rink earlier this year. I instantly recognised you, having been an X Factor fan in my younger days. What year was it that you were on there, and where did you finish?
It feels like 100 years ago. It was 10 years ago, so that this year, coming up this year. And it was 2013, so and I finished sixth, I think. So, top 10. So, yeah, it was good. It was good fun. Obviously, a crazy, crazy time for me, and life's changed a lot, and I've done lots of different things since. But that's what life's about, isn't it? Trying different things and just experiencing as much of life as you can. So
how old were you when you did the X Factor?
19, yeah. So I'll be 29 next year. I turned 20 just sort of, yeah, so 20 after X Factor, so what, like, when we, I think we were just done the tour, we just finished the X Factor tour. So,
yeah. So, I mean, I'm going to show off my X Factor nerdiness here. I think Sam Bailey won that year, didn't she?
She did. Yeah. surely you've googled this. No, this isn't just.
No. I've done virtually no research.
Really?
Because I want you to tell me. But the is there anyone else from that year who's actually been quite successful musically?
There's not. For the tape, I shook my head. No, I think, generally, like, it depends what you see as success. I think what, like, we're all kind of, you know, on the same page that you've got, you know, your Ollie Merses and your One Directions and Fiona Lewis, people like that have gone on and had amazing careers. for me, I 2 years ago when COVID hit, I started doing personal training, but I've literally just kind of slowed down on music. So really, I've had a career in music and a solid career. You know, bought a house and did some other bits and bobs through music, and I've had a great time. So to me, like, that's relative success, but it's not. But I'm not Ollie Mers, like, I'm not pretending to be. Do you know what I mean?
I would certainly see that as a success.
Yeah, so I've had a great time, you know, and there's some time for change for me now. But I mean, we can get into that later. But yeah, so I mean, we had Luke Friend was one of my one of the other boys, Nicky McDonald, Scottish guy. They were the boys that they both got down to the final. With Sam Bailey, so yeah, but it was a whirlwind.
I can imagine, yeah. So I mean, obviously finishing sixth, then you got to go on the tour as a finalist at 19 years old. How dramatically did your life change?
It was chaos. I tell you what, was strange. There was a moment on the plane on the way back from judges' houses when I'd got through and I knew that I was going to be on the live shows. Yeah. So only 12 finalists get on to the live shows. And I knew that everybody at the time watched X Factor. It was, you know, there's 12 million people watching.
It was
in its prime. So, and I remember being on the plane, looking out the window, as we come back into the UK, you see all the lights from the houses and the buildings. I thought literally pretty much every one of them houses will have the X Factor on, you know, very, very soon. And my face on their telly, which was a really strange feeling at 19, like you say. And that was, I think, the moment where I realised that, you know, forever, for how long, I didn't know. But for a moment, at least, life was going to change dramatically for me for a while. So yeah, I think that was the moment I was like, oh, my goodness, this is going to be mad.
How long did you have to keep it all a secret then?
I was allowed to tell, to be honest, I can't even remember if I was allowed to or not, but I did tell like my close friends and family. But yeah, you just kind of keep it under wraps. What they do, they get you into the house. So there's an X Factor house. They get you into the house very, like, soon after you come from judges' houses. So basically the whole time period where people are watching the X Factor, and you go through all the rounds and bits and bobs like that, you know where to tell anyone. Do you know what I mean? You're not mixing with your mates. Yeah, you're not mixing with your mates. You're not going to work. You're not, you know, you're basically on lockdown. So that's how they managed to kind of keep things a surprise in that.
And who was your coach, your judge?
Louis Walsh.
Because I think I've not particularly researched it, but I have listened to a couple of your other interviews. And I do remember Gary Barlow not being particularly fond of you. Now, yep. Was that all scripted and just sort of circus drama?
I mean, I know as much as you do. I mean, at the end of the day, what I would say is what I learned is it's very much a big pantomime, X Factor. You know, it's there for your entertainment, and hence why, you know, certain people have gone really far that a lot of us would probably look at and go, I don't know if they should have done.
Yeah.
But you know what I'm talking about. In the competition, you know, sometimes you get those, they're labelled in the press and stuff, as it were, as joke acts. You know, and they're for our entertainment. And that's the same reason that the judges have to play a part, you know, and you've got your bad guy, your good cop, bad cop. And often, for years and years, Simon Cowell has been bad cop. Well, on my year, we didn't have Simon Cowell. We had Gary Barlow. So Gary, I suppose, played bad cop. And it was, yeah, it was great. But he didn't like me. you know, the other thing about it is what I think one of the things that keeps you in the competition, other than your singing and your music and your talent and stuff, is staying relevant. Once you get to that stage, once you get to the point where you're in the press and stuff, if you stay relevant, people keep wanting to watch you. People keep wanting to vote for you, things like that. And in all of Gary's sort of hate, like all of Gary's effort to hate me, what he did do was keep me relevant because he kept talking about me.
Yeah. It might be an Essex thing, because he didn't have a similar problem with Ryland Neal, didn't he?
Yeah. I mean, and me and Ryland are very different. although Ryland's a great guy. But I don't know. I mean, there was a point where we were backstage and I had my guitar and we had a little jam, me and Gary Barlow. So he kind of hated me that much.
What a memory that is for you. That's incredible.
Yeah. I've got some good memories.
I suppose that's the main thing of it. What, I mean, an incredible experience to have at that time of your life. And you've got memories to last a lifetime. And as you say, what you've done with your music for yourself personally, you can't say that's anything but a success. It's brilliant.
I really appreciate that. Thank you very much. It's funny because I get both things now. Like yourself, you were like, I recognised you as soon as I saw you. And that's really lovely. But I also get people go, I know you from somewhere. I usually say Crime Watch.
I couldn't pick your name out of my head, but I said to my daughter, I said, I'm sure he was on the X Factor. He's a local guy, and I'm sure he was on the X Factor.
Yeah, so I get that a fair bit. And the other thing you get is a lot of people turn around and go, keep at it, don't stop singing and stuff like that. And you're like, thanks. Like, but yeah,
not realising that you still are.
Yeah, or not just that, but like, I've had 6-7 top 40s from songs I've released. I've performed in all over the world, globally, in America and bits and bobs like that. I had a number one dance hit in America, which is a collab in a house tune that I did. And I've had a career where I've done arena tour. You know, I've performed to 20,000 people at the O2 and at Wembley. And yeah, to me, those were all the things that were on my little tick list, really. I'm not Ed Sheeran, but I've done a lot of what was on my tick list, which is great, you know. Yeah. And I'm still, you know, I'm not 19 like I was when I was on the X Factor, but that's because we're all human; we all get older. But I'm not exactly old.
You know, I mean, in the order of what I have done, you know, preparation. In the order of what I've done, I've actually got this last. But I did see on your Instagram the other day you put a post out about adulting and how your life has to change, and with the roller coaster that your life has been in the last 10 years, I'm assuming that you've got to keep some sort of mental stability to just keep yourself together.
Yeah, and I've done a lot over the years to do with mental health for that reason. And I think the more you take on in life, and the more pressure you put on yourself, the more susceptible you are to having issues, whether it's anxieties or whether it's mental health issues, I mean, of different kinds. I think that the more pressure you put on yourself and the more you want to achieve and the more you go and try and do, those changes become much more difficult for you and open you up and expose you to the likes, you know, things like mental health troubles and issues and problems. I've certainly in that sense I've certainly had my battles, but I like to think I've got a great support system, to be honest. And I like to think so far I've handled them all right.
Yeah, well, obviously, I mean over the last 10 years the increase in sort of social media alone would have, and in your position coming from the X Factor, would have almost painted a target on your back for online trolls. And I mean, how do you deal with that? Because I mean, I've only been doing the podcast for like 4 months and I've had no hate yet. I'm sure it's coming, but I've had none yet.
Right. Well, the first thing I can say is my blocked list on my Twitter, my Instagram, even my WhatsApp, people have managed to get my number over the years several times, is like longer than the Yellow Pages for phone numbers and you know, social media handles. I block people. I don't know you. I don't need to know your opinion. If you don't like me, I'd rather not hear it. So I'm going to block you. Like, I've got better and worse at different times throughout my career and throughout my life at dealing with it. But it's also where what you see is better and worse. Sometimes I got better and I thought, well, I didn't react to that. Yeah. But then other times I've given them a load of abuse back, and I thought, yeah, you dealt that well. So, I mean, it depends on what you think. But for me, I think there was also a time where I was very aware that what I say on social media may have an impact on my career, may have an impact on my fans, and what I do next. As I get older, I seem to care a lot less about that. I seem to go, you know, if you don't like me.
Absolutely, yeah.
But I think, you know, you just learn to cope. It's all very well, though, saying this is what I say or this is what I don't say. How it affects you mentally, whether you open your mouth or not, is a different story. And you do have to develop very thick skin. If you do what I've done over the years and you don't have thick skin, you won't do what I've done over the years.
No, you'll crack under the pressure, won't you, I think?
100%. It's like, you know, there's a lot of things that people don't like, you know, and a lot of it, some of it's jealousy, some of it's just opinion, and some of it, a lot of it is just, I don't know if I can swear on this podcast.
We keep it cleanish, but
a lot of it has
got an explicit language warning from one of the other guests, so I think you'd be all right.
All right, sweet, yeah. But, you know, Bellends is, I feel like, bridges the gap nicely. But, yeah. And there are a lot of them. You know, the world is full of them.
There's loads, isn't there, yeah.
Yeah, you're always going to come across them.
Yeah, it's amazing you never come across that many nice people, is it?
Unfortunately not. No. My sister's always said to me, if people aren't hating on you for what you do, you're not doing anything worth hating on.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I think that's quite a good way of looking at it. Like, you know, if you don't try and step out your comfort zone, don't do things that people can get jealous of, people can take umbrage to, then, you know, you'd have to sit in a dark room, not do anything, not move, because literally in life, you can't please everybody. Sometimes people have things to say, so, you know, you just got to deal with it when they do.
So, well, stepping out of your comfort zone, you went from singing into motor racing. Now, was that a passion of you when you were younger, or did you just go in raw?
Yeah, so funnily enough, there's a connection to me between motor racing and hockey. So I'll get to it in a second. But motor racing, I've always loved. My dad used to race cars before I was born. So that's where the passion comes from. I'm an absolute lunatic, just have been since child. I love it. And anything that's dangerous or exciting or dangerous or fast is exciting to me. So yeah. I started off when I was nine, I did motocross. And then I started doing go-karting. And to be honest, I was rubbish. Nearly. Because I was banzai. My dad would I'd do some testing. My dad would pull me into the pits and he'd be like, right, change this, do that, be a bit more smooth here and go and do it. And you'll take seconds off your lap time. I was like, okay, dad, I'll go and do that. I'd go and do exactly the same again, not listen to anything he said. And he'd be like, well, what's the point of me trying to teach you? Nowadays, as an adult, I'm able to take on criticism a bit more and understand why I should do certain things. And it's meant that my dad's advice has made me quite quick in the car.
Yeah.
But it was generally, it was a hobby. Five years ago this year, my dad turned around and he's always looked at the classifieds and looked at race cars and gone, oh, should we get it? Should we do this? But he said this time, I'm going to get a race car. And he said, I'm going to go racing again. And I turned around and was like, right, but not without me. I'm coming with you. I'm going to do it as well. you know, I'm old enough and silly enough to make my own decisions. So that's what I did. And it's just absolutely snowballed from there.
That's brilliant. Brilliant. So do you still do it now?
Yeah. I'm racing in two championships this year.
Oh, brilliant.
I'm racing a 3.2 litre Porsche in Porsche Great Britain.
Very nice. Yeah. Is that connected to the work you do now then with cars?
Only that they're cars.
But they're very nice cars, aren't they?
Oh yeah, absolutely. So I'm a sales specialist at Saxton 4x4 at the moment, And we sell some fantastic cars there.
And they've got themselves a little plug there.
Yeah. Well, you know, Chelmsford Chieftains, they're in Chelmsford. Maybe we'll get some hockey players in cars. but realistically, you know, for me, I like a hustle. I like selling. Even when I was doing music, you know, there was points where you're selling yourself to venues to go and perform at different places. You're obviously selling your music. You're selling yourself all the time on social media. Yeah. Last year, I raced in the GT4 Super Cup and also raced Porsches as well. And I raised a whole bunch of money selling marketing packages in motorsport. And basically, end of last year, I turned around and went, I need change. I need some stability in my life, because although music has been fantastic, I am getting older. And there comes a point when you go, right, I need a little bit more security, a little bit more stability for the things that the chapter that comes next in my life, yeah. Which is really exciting, but for completely different reasons.
Part so that's of the when adult,
I suppose. Yeah, that comes into that whole post, you know, about adulting. But so that's where I am right now. But I mean, there wasn't a necessarily like a direct connection between motorsport and what I do now. It's just that I like selling and I definitely like nice cars. So yeah.
That does go hand in hand. And you said there was a connection to the hockey as well for the motorsport.
Yeah. So just there's not many sports, right, that I go to and get like sheer adrenaline from watching. Motorsport, you know, whether it's rallying, circuit racing, drifting, whatever, you know, does it for me all day. I love when I'm watching racing. There's a little bit of argy-bargy, you know, people getting their elbows out a bit, knocking door mirrors and bits and bobs. And it happens to us, you know, especially the further you get up the front of the grid, the more people will do that. It's technically a non-contact sport, but it happens. So, and I love it because it's passionate. It's like, you know, tooth and nail fighting to win, to make it happen, you know, and to bring home the trophy.
Yeah.
And I see that in the players when I go and watch hockey. And it's exactly the same thing in a completely different way, in a different sport. And, you know, and there's, when you watch these footballers now, you know, they brush past each other. They can breathe on each other and they're on the floor crying.
Yeah.
And then you've got these guys. The first hockey game I went to watch, my friend Callum in the Chelmsford Chieftains. And there's a guy there bleeding from his eye socket, just cracking on, just still playing. And he's giving as good as he's getting, you know. And I was like, that is, you know, they're absolutely sending it out there. There's a no care attitude. They're just giving as much as they can. All of their, you know, there's so much heart that goes into the game. Yeah. And that is what I hope I bring to racing and other drivers that I aspire to be like, bring to that sport. And I think that's why, to me, it's different to hockey, to golf, to cricket, to football, to golf, to cricket, to the other sports that there seem to be a lot more mainstream in the UK. But for me, they don't even compare.
No, it's definitely part of the reason I started this was to try and bring hockey to a wider audience. Because, I mean, as people know with me, that I've not been following the Chieftains for years and years and years like some, because I didn't know it was there. But, and I think motorsport is one of the niche sports that you kind of, you're into it or you're not. And if you're into it, you're really into it and you watch.
Like me.
You follow it everywhere. And it's similar with hockey. Once you get into it, it's quite addictive.
Yeah, absolutely.
And before you know it, you're sitting in your front room at 3 o'clock in the morning watching NHL.
Well, funny enough, funny you say that. I'd never been to a hockey game before I went and watched Callum, in Chelmsford. And then last year, we went to, my brother lives in America, and he went when he got married out there, and we went as a family to America. And my girlfriend, who came with me to watch Chieftains, came with us. And before we left, we were like, well, we have to go and watch, because we were in Boston. So we went and watched the Bruins. It was fantastic. And the atmosphere, the way that they do it out there, we don't do anything like that. There's literally nothing that compares with the atmosphere and the way that they, you know, they run their sport. It's insane.
Yeah, it's an incredible. I mean, even over here, I spoke to Sean McMorrow, who's Canadian, and he'd played in America and Canada, and he played over here, and he said that the atmosphere over here was better than it was in America.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, he played the professional, the elite league level. He played for Belfast and Dundee.
Okay.
Over here, but he says that the British crowd have almost like that football mentality at ice hockey and sort of get up for it a bit more. And he said, you can go to an NHL game in Canada, like go to Toronto, and all the people are sitting there in their suits and don't want to spill their cappuccino, they don't want to get too into it.
Yeah, but well, to be like, fair,
down to the Plexi, and all the real fans are down there and having a beer and a hot dog, and it's rowdy.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I do like, you know, that is what I love about it. The fans have as much passion as the players. Yeah. But one of the things I do remember talking to my brother about, he's an American football fan. Yeah. And he was saying, he said, like, you know, I went and watched American football with my mates. And then when they came over to England, we went and watched a football game, a soccer game, right? And he took them there and they're all shouting and everyone's screaming and stuff. And obviously, you know, British people, there's a lot of swearing. There's some terrible abuse that happens at these football games. Yeah. And his American friends were sitting there like, why are they all so angry? He was like, no, it's banter. It's just how it is in the UK. It's different.
It's something you don't actually see at hockey. I mean, hockey is actually, considering the, as you said, obviously, with the physical side, the speed, and occasionally the violence that happens in the sport, it's marketed as a family-friendly sport.
Yeah.
Because, you know, there isn't that behaviour in the rinks and in the arenas, the swearing, the abuse. Generally, it's quite family friendly.
Yeah. So, maybe not so much on the ice, but
no, but I think that's the beauty of it. I mean, yeah, you mentioned coming to watch Callum. I'm assuming when you trained to be a PT, you did a bit of work with our Captain Handsome.
Yeah, Captain Handsome. Any too pretty to do hockey. So So that's last couple of years. I've done personal training. I started it because COVID happened and there was less gigs. And I was like, well, I need to do something else. And I had the qualification, so I was like, right, well, I'll use that and I'll go and start training people. And I met Callum at VIP where I used to train people.
You're very good at this.
You know what? I just talk in detail. That's why. It was great, and you know, I had a great time there. But me and Callum like seemed to hit it off well, and so he was always he's a really nice bloke, and you know what he said about there aren't very many nice people as much as there are bellends. And so I get drawn to nice people, and when we talked about stuff like. He was always very, very interested in, you know, in my life and in my motor racing and stuff like that. And so I was used to ask about hockey, but I never really knew anything about it. Like, I'd be interested and I'd pretend to sort of be like, oh, yeah, like, must be mad. But I didn't know anything about it, so I've got to get to a game. So I got to the game and I said to my missus, I was like, we're coming all the time. I was like, this is brilliant. I was like, we've got to keep coming to this. And I was hooked. So I'll definitely be coming again.
Yeah. I think he's incredibly mature for a young man.
He is.
He's got a very wise head on his shoulders.
He is. He is very, very mature. And I found out he was telling me how he's the only one that's allowed to wear the Union Jack on his shorts. Because he's played for GB. Which I thought was quite an accolade. That's quite a cool thing.
Yeah, there is a few lads in there that have represented Great Britain at various levels.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's...
Well, it's a great very high standard. Chieftains is, you know, brilliant team.
Yeah. Yes, really, I mean, it's amazing. I spoke to a few people that have sort of said, you know, that don't understand the game in this country, and they've said, you know, is there like an FA Cup where the teams from all the leagues will compete? And you have to explain to them that it wouldn't work because if Chieftains played a team, like if they played Manchester Storm from the Elite League, it'd be 30-40 nil.
Yeah. Well, that's one of the things is, I mean, you look at a football game and it can, you know, they can do 90 minutes or extra time and nil-nil.
But, no goals.
Yeah, you know, that doesn't really happen as much in hockey. You know,
and the goals are tiny in comparison.
They are. It tends to be a lot more action-packed. I think it's great,
but yeah, no. The level, I mean, the things with the levels. I mean, it's something you probably won't be overly aware of as being new to the sport. Is the rules on the foreign players that can come in and how many can play and whatnot. And in the Elite League, they're allowed, I think it's 14,
right,
foreign players. So when you've got a team full of Canadians and Lithuanians and Finnish players. They're all top, top quality. Whereas we're only allowed two.
So, right, okay.
And, yeah, and one of them's a goalkeeper.
Yeah, so Callum has sort of taught me about the pace. He's saying the pace is very different. Because obviously he came from a different team to Chieftains. And he was saying how he gets a lot more ice time. He said, but the pace is different. Anyway, I went to America and watched Boston, watched the Bruins. And oh my goodness, how quick they trying to keep an eye on the puck at any one time. It's nigh on impossible. Like, it's so difficult. I don't know how they'd see it when they've got their helmet on and they're, you know, skating at the speeds they skate. It's incredible.
Yeah, it's a skill level to be in awe of, actually, which I think a lot of us that are sports fans are when you see a sport as skillful as hockey.
Yeah.
Similar to, you know, jumping in a car and driving it around a track at 200 mile an hour. That's not only does that take skill, that takes incredible nerve.
Yeah, or stupidity.
Yeah, it's similar with hockey, I suppose.
Yeah, it's certainly a bit of a wake up when you're doing 130, and someone taps your door mirror, and you're like, "Hang on a minute."
Have you ever fancied having a go with ice hockey yourself?
Do you know what? Like, I don't have enough time.
Yeah.
But I have said, you know, my granddad was a boxer, and I always said, if I had more time, I'd have a go at boxing. And since going to watch ice hockey, it's a similar thing. I've gone, do you know what? If I have more time, that's a sport I'd get involved with. Because it is right up my street. I love it. Same reason I love watching it. I'm somebody who's always been very time poor, but that's because of the way I choose to live my life. Like, you know, I've done my music. I do a lot of training, you know, whether it was personal training or training myself. Then I picked up the racing. Now I'm not only in my racing, I'm racing in two championships this year, and I've got a full-time job. Like, do you know what I mean? I don't know when I would, you'd have to invent more days in the week for me to get involved, but if that was possible, I'd be there.
It's something I've been sort of toying with and playing around with, that I would really like to have a sort of a charity event where I could put a team together of, you know, fans or people that are involved with the club to just all have a go. It would be awful to watch, I'm sure.
No. But the thing about it is, you know, you can do that with a football match because everybody, you know, can run.
Yeah.
You know, most people can kick a ball, whether it's going to be in the right direction or not.
Yeah. And there's pitches everywhere.
Yeah, and it's something we learn at school, football. Like, whereas I can skate in a straight line, you know, but the chances of me falling over are quite high. But how they, you know, they literally turn on a sixpence, they skate backwards, and they do, you know, and keep an eye on where the puck's going and where their stick is and, you know, everything else. And I just think that you couldn't do that. That's why you couldn't, to do a charity game with normal people, it would be carnage.
It'd be good fun, but carnage.
Can you imagine trying to insure it?
No, we wouldn't even go that far. We wouldn't bother insurance. Just sign your own waiver.
That's it. Yeah, you'd have to sign waivers, wouldn't you?
Well, considering how time poor you are, mate, I'm really, really glad that you spent 20 minutes with me this evening. It's been a really, really good chat to hear about your music career, your motorsport career, and now your love of the Chieftains. Do you know when you're going to get to a game next?
I don't. I need to actually. Callum just messaged me about doing this, so he was just like, he said he's gonna take a listen. So. I will speak to him afterwards and see what
happens. Yeah, we do have a rare home game on a Saturday this week, so we actually have a Saturday night home game.
Right, okay.
Which is very rare.
We'll definitely get to one soon. And if you're there and you see me there, come say hello, and likewise, I'll do the same.
Yeah, I'm there for every home game. I don't get to as many as away games as I like because it's a lot of planning and a lot of travelling. But yeah, every home game. So yeah, we'd love to see you there at some point.
Brilliant. Thank you very much. Cheers for having me.
No worries. Thank you for joining me, mate.
A huge thank you to Sam Callahan for joining me on Zero Pucks Given. Really interesting to hear all the stories from the X Factor days and what's happened to him since. So, yeah, really, really interesting insight into his life. And hopefully, never know, maybe a charity game or something, we might get to see him on the ice at some point. My next guest tonight, then, is another podcast host like me, but he's come from a place of pure experience, former hockey player, all among the leagues in Great Britain. And now the host of 4,000 and Counting, one of the top British ice hockey podcasts. Little warning, there is a little bit of colourful language in this chat that we've had. So just the explicit language warning there. But I sat down and had a chat with Nicky Watt.
On a gathering storm comes a tall, handsome man in a dusty black coat with a red right hand.
Nicky Watt, how are we doing, fella?
I am very well. On the other side of the mic today, looking forward to it.
Yeah, it's so it must be quite a new experience for you. So you're a Basingstoke man, but I believe you're actually Scottish.
Yeah, I was born in Irvine in Scotland. My dad's an MOD copper, so he moved down to Basingstoke when I was six, and that's when I enrolled in the Hockey Basics program down in Basingstoke, and went through from Hockey Basics to the Elite League 10-year stretch. From 16 and from six in Hockey Basics to my first Elite League game at 16, all the way through Basingstoke.
So 6 years old, a good young age. Did you and your brother start at the same time?
Yeah, he was maybe a little bit after me. He was a little bit young. I think he was 2.5. So I think he started playing when he was 3.5. You know, little brother always wanting to just get involved and be in the mix. And then just little images of him and shirts too big, like running around the ice, to a year or two later, ripping it up and absolutely dominating against kids that were like 8, 9 and 10. He was 6 and just like running riot.
Absolutely brilliant. What got you started on it then? Was it the only real sport in Basingstoke?
It is one of the only real sports in Basingstoke. No, I'll tell you what though, back when I was a kid, Basingstoke Town were in what was then like the Conference of Football. You know, the one just below, I think they call it like the top non-league. They were in that. And at that point, Basingstoke Rugby as well were in like the National. So then they were quite good. But now, I mean, Basingstoke Town don't even have a ground. And the rugby team aren't quite what they used to be. So yeah, Basingstoke's Bison has kind of always been like the biggest show in town. The old man played for Air Bruins and Air Raiders with guys like Frankie Morris, Danny Shea, Tommy Serrell, Rocky Saganuk was a coach. I mean, obviously anyone that is a bit of a veteran that listens to this podcast, a bit of an OG, will know those names I just rattled out, like some fucking superstars from back in the day, like big time superstars. So my dad got to play with those guys.
Your dad was an influence in getting you both playing.
Absolutely. And here's a story for you off the bat. So when my dad was in air, the young backup goalie, as it was then, there was no fucking Chelmsford rule. There was no under 16 rule then. We had a young 13-year-old Pete Russell as the backup goalie.
Wow.
And now, obviously, going on to be a GB. My dad said Pete was like one of my favourite players when I was like running around in the locker room and stuff like that. I mean, I don't remember any of that. I was like tiny little babe in arms, do you know what I mean? But yeah, I thought it was quite interesting that Pete went from back up at Lincoln Road and Air to Pool A, GB, national team coach.
Yeah. I think getting that early start, I mean, now it's obviously with the Chelmsford rule, obviously they can't be under 16. But even then, you're seeing now 16-year-olds progress quite quickly, aren't you, from that?
Well, imagine if you gave them a chance.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Imagine if you give some of these kids a chance. Like, I mean, the WHL, I know we're talking junior hockey, but the WHL, they gave exceptional status to Bedard. The OHL gave exceptional status to McDavid. The Quebec Major Junior League did it for Lafreniere. I think there needs to be at some stage a discussion in place within the EIHA, Ice Hockey UK, whoever it has to be, that maybe 3 times a year we let our 3 best 15-year-olds have exceptional status and at least be allowed to train. I mean, I started training with a Bison when I was 13. I played my first Best of British game. I don't know if that's probably before your time. Best of British back in the BNL days. BNL was, I think, it was there or thereabouts. You had one Brit for every import. So if there was 10 imports, there was 10 Brits. For 9 imports, 9 Brits, whatever, however it worked out. And then they would do a competition to get the younger guys involved, to get the juniors involved. It's called the Best of British. And I think the Best of British essentially made it down to like an EPL game. I think you had to chop your imports down to 3 or 4.
Wow.
And though it was a different competition, but it was good. I mean, when I was involved, it was Basingstoke Bison, Slough Jets, Guildford Flames, Peterborough Pirates, it would have been then. So you're 13, 14. I'm getting to go. Minus the five imports, you've still got four imports on the ice, and you've still got all your veteran British National League players. So you were competing against like fully grown men. And I remember it was like myself, Joe Green, or Kurt Reynolds. We were the kind of guys from Basingstoke that were stepping up and playing in that competition. And that just stood me in good stead. I think the year after I played as a 14, 15-year-old, played like 16 games, 17 games in the BNL. And obviously played my junior hockey as well. So Monday night, I'd be skating 16s, 19s, and then Tuesday would be Bison. Wednesday, 16, 19s, Thursday, Friday, Bison, and then you'd be playing either 16s, 19s, or Bison at the weekend. It was
non-stop.
Yeah, it was 7 days a week. And I mean, it's funny because we always bitch about ice time in this country. Well, let the fucking kids play up. And all of a sudden, there's a couple of extra hours a week, and then let them play with the men. And then all of a sudden, there's a couple of extra hours a week. And all these kids that are going abroad to get 8-10 hours a week training could be getting it here, if you just maybe relax the rules a little bit.
Do you think that this the EIHA have kind of rebranded their pathway into the draft? Could that be good for it?
So I just done a YouTube video. Go and check it out on 4000 YouTube channel. Like we broke it right down, like a 20-minute video. I kind of like it.
Mm.
I like the aspect of it. I think especially with the 16s and 18s, you don't need any more than 40 kids. You try to pick a 20-man roster to go for England or GB, whatever it may be. So trimming the rosters right down and having the best 40 kids face off against each other is only going to be good.
Yeah.
Because if you think about it, let's say every team, Southwest, Southeast, North, Midlands, let's take their best 10 players. Okay, that's going to be their top two lines. So now that's all we've got. There is no more third or fourth line guys.
Yeah.
So you're facing off with essentially what should be the best possible outcome of talent. And that should then, in order, step the game up because it's better players playing against better players. And the experience should be better for them. If they do it right, there will be no one-sided games. Sometimes at the conference setup, there is a potential, you know, let's say the 94 year for the Southwest, really, really good. So they go out and win four games. They spank the North 7-1. They spank the Southeast 6-1, blah, blah, blah. So they don't have competitive games that year. And then let's say the birth year after are a load of shit, then they go up there and they get dicked four games.
Yeah.
And they don't have any development either. So it all depends on the luck of your birth year. And like, really, because some clubs, and there's other situations where you have what I had with Southwest, where out of my 1 year that we won it, and the last players, it was a choice between Jordan Kelsall and Tyler Cooper. Tyler Cooper obviously went on to play for GB20s. He went and played at Shat St. Mary's in America. I cut him. There was probably four guys that I could have taken into that Southwest team. We were so strong. On a year like it would be now, I'd have had 23 guys out of the 40 if we were picking the best guys. Like our region was that strong. So if we were looking at the 40 best players in the country, 23 of them would have come from the Southwest. Now, it's going to be interesting to see how they do this and who's going to get their knickers in a twist when they go, oh my God, you didn't select anyone from the North. There is no North anymore. There is no Midlands anymore. It's done. It's finished. We need to get that thought straight out the brain, because I can guarantee parents are going to say, oh, well, my son didn't get picked because of this or because of that. He didn't get looked at because if they do their due diligence properly, and they talk to plenty of coaches, they talk to plenty of players and people that have been around the game, and make sure they do pick the best 40 kids, there's no reason why it won't be a massive success at the 16, 18th level. Also love the fact that they've brought in like a fitness style combine. That'll get the little fuckers going, won't it?
Yeah, that will. I did share the points of it the other day, because it just looked really exciting when it came out, and a good sort of change.
Well, they're gonna have to get in the gym. You don't want to be the one with the least amount of reps at bench press. Let me tell you, because there's gonna be another 30, 40 guys stood around there. That will get on top real quick. If you're losing all the fitness tests, it's not gonna be a good look for you.
No, the banter will certainly be flying around, won't it?
Oh, for sure. Especially at that age. I mean, like I said, I've coached this under 15 conference, under 17s conference. I mean, I was 26 when I was my last year doing that. I was 26, 36 now. Some of the most fucking fun I've ever had being involved with hockey is going away with those conference lads, because I was in the EPL, and I always thought a lot of these guys were already training at that level. Don't treat them like a bunch of 16-year-olds. Just treat them like you would treat the EPL boys. And then obviously that means like they're way more relaxed and they're a good laugh. You let a bunch of 20 lads that are, you know, 16, 17 away from their parents for a few hours, and they're quite a crack.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, they've certainly got a bit of character, haven't they? I know we had an issue with the GB under-18s, I think, late last year when they went away, and there was someone was sent home quite early.
Mate, it happens, and I mean, I've got a couple of GB 18 stories if you want them. So we went away. My first year GB 18s, we went away and we basically picked a Scotland team, and we were fucking rubbish and we got absolutely smoked. We was in the division with Germany, Latvia, so we were like in the group 1A, so the one below the top. Yeah. We had no right being there. Like I think the age group below before was kind of, don't know how they fruit getting us in there, but we're in there. And yeah, it was painful. We got absolutely smoked in pretty much every game. But we went to a warm-up tournament in France and we played our first game out in the mountains. And we come in and France had been like a pool A nation. And they only beat us 4-3.
Oh, wow.
And we were like, fucking hell, lads, we're all right there. Don't know, we're all right. We're not bad. We'll sit and go back to the hotel. Everyone's like, yeah, I think we're going to be all right. We play them the next night, and it was the weirdest experience ever. So you skate out, and this barn had no plexi along one side. So it's the fans were just like sat there, ribbing the pucks out, and it was going into the stands. It was nuts. But yeah, go out for warm up, and it was one of them. I didn't know if like the fans had heard that it was like 4-3 the day before, and there was nobody there. Go in, like we're all getting our kit off, you know, shooting the shit, getting ready to go out for the game. Go back out, and it was like a flash mob. The place was rammed. There wasn't a seat left in the barn. So the atmosphere was wicked. And then I'm sure one of the GB boys will correct me if I'm wrong, but I think we lost 16-1.
Oh, wow. So
we lost 16-1. Yeah. I got kicked out of that game. So shout out to Peter Johnson for coming in and having my back with this. So obviously I'll play a physical game. I don't know, fucking 7-0 down or something. It's not good. And we could come in, we're getting a bollocking at the end of the first. So somebody do something. So okay. So don't tell me twice. Puck goes down in the net, run the goalie a little bit. Puck goes behind the net, run the D-man. Get fucking loads of penalties. Come back in. Alan Anderson, Beans going mental at me, shouting at me. I was like, I didn't like him. I fucking didn't like the guy anyway. So now me and him are getting after it. I was like, fuck it. So I take my kit off. And Peter Johnson comes in the room. He's like, what are you guys shouting at? And he goes, well, you told the boys, someone go do something. So what, you get your fucking kit back on right now? I'm like, okay. I'm like, okay, what am I doing? Am I putting my kit back on? Because everyone's obviously in the room. It's like, what is going on right now? But yeah, then we went off into that tournament and got smashed. The next year, we had Pete Russell. We went to Lithuania. We won gold. It was myself, Mark Richardson, Tom Carlon. So obviously, Mark Richardson was my roommate for that. What a career that man's had. Absolute legend in the Elite League. And yeah, we won every game, won the gold medal. And we basically, it was weird then. Nowhere really had regular flights to Lithuania. So I think we finished the tournament and there was no flight back the day after. So we were like, we won the tournament. We had that night and then we had a whole entire day and then we flew back the next day. It was 60p for 20 Marlboro lights at the shop over the road. It was like fucking £2 for a litre of vod. And then you go around the corner and obviously once we'd won, we was like allowed to go out for a couple of beers. So we go out for a couple of beers and you're ordering pints and the pints are not pints, they're like
that's
yeah, like they're decent size, and you're ordering like, I don't know, however many lads, because obviously you break up into little groups, so it's maybe like eight beers, and she's like, so it's like £4. We're like, what the fuck is going on? We got 2 days of this, so everybody's just getting after it for 2 days. We go out for a team meal, and there's a just absolute carnage, like you say about players getting sent home. Hotel got a little bit wrecked, and fucking everybody was a little bit naughty, had a little bit of fun. But those under 18 trips are what it's all about. They're so much fun for the lads.
It's memories, and I suppose, and as well as just being obviously like learning, obviously progressing with hockey, it's about sort of learning as a group of men, isn't it? And that camaraderie, especially if you go through the age groups together.
Yeah, I'll tell you what else is a learning experience. So our first year was in Pool A. We had guys, our goalies were Davey Lawrence and Jeff Woodhouse, both involved in coaching now and stuff like that. I'm trying to think of some of the other guys. Adam Walker, he's Paisley Pirates coach now. And just a few other guys. And we're gambling on the bus. And I've never seen a fucking card game get out of control as quick as some of those GB18 card games. Guys losing like £1,000 a hand. This is 17 years old playing a game called Ding the Pot, and it go around and whatever, and there's two cards, and if you hit, so there's two cards sat there, let's say it's a, I don't know, four and a 10, and you got to be in between it. So when that card turns over, you've got to be like a six. Sweet, happy days. And if you though hit a four or a 10, you got to like double the pot. Oh, mate, you were seeing like 40 quid, 80 quid, 160, 320, fucking 640. We're like, whoa, 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 boys, we're fucking 1,500 quid hands. It was mental. The coaching staff had to come in and be like, all right, that's it. Like, no more. Like, you're banned from playing that game. It was getting outrageous. Because you play your games and you train, and then you're just sat at the hotel all day. I don't know what the lads did during the COVID one. That must have been a nightmare, but it was bad enough back then. All you did was sit in each other's rooms. You gambled, and I mean, like, no one was bringing PlayStations on the road. No one was on the smartphones. No one was doing any of that shit.
No, different times then, I suppose, isn't it? But you, I mean, you must have played or at least spectated at every single rink in the UK. Have you got a particular favourite and maybe a worst one?
My favourite rink is Belfast.
Yeah. They're
absolutely love. Yeah. It was known as the Odyssey when I played there. I think it's the SSE now. But yeah, when I got to play there, how long have Belfast been going? 20 years?
Was it 90? Yeah, 91, 92. But it's, yeah, it must be.
No, later than that. Let's have a look.
I'm doing that thing where people say, oh, you know, you remember 30 years ago and you think it's 1970.
Yeah.
But 30 years ago it was actually 1993.
I know, it's crazy. Belfast Giants, let's have a look. I reckon I played there maybe the year or the year after it was open, founded in 2000, so yeah, when I played there in the 2003 2004 season, so it was still like a brand new rink. We was playing in Bainstoke. Our rink's a shithole, so you go on a road to this, and like the locker rooms, like, I don't know, it's like an NHL locker room. It's got the countdown clock timer on the wall and all that. It's got the TV with the Zamboni. You know exactly what you're doing. Separate area. This is the away room, like separate area for the physios, somewhere to put all the sticks in that properly, set up the grinder. And then you go out there and the atmosphere is always good in Belfast. The night out after is always good in Belfast. It's just, yeah, Belfast for me. Worst rink? Oh, there's a few. Solent and Gosport's a shithole.
I think we label that one as interesting when we discuss it.
I know a lot of people didn't like the Isle of Wight, but when I played on the, I didn't like it until you play there, and then when you play for the island, tell you what a barn! It's so good because the fans there. You talk about nothing to do in Bainstow. There's really nothing to do in the island.
Right, is it?
Yeah, and they were wicked. I need to turn that light around. It's fucking shining my head blue. But yeah, worst. See, again, it's hard. Peterborough's a shithole. But then when I prayed for Peterborough and you're actually in the home dressing room before the game, it's not too bad because the home dressing room is quite nice. It's warm. You've got nice stalls and all these other things. Whereas the away change room, everyone's kind of crammed in there. It's freezing. The floor's wet. It stinks. The shower's like piss dribble, like two dribbles. It takes the whole team like an hour to get showered because you can't. It's just, yeah, Peterborough's got to be up there, actually.
That sort of thing I hear happens sort of quite a lot, especially a lot of the older rinks where the away dressing room almost for that psychological edge.
Invicta was bad for it. I mean, obviously it's been a while since I've been there, but Invicta's old dressing room was a shithole as well. Just try to think what other ones. I mean, there's quite a few. Look at Basingstoke right now. It's my home rink. It's nigh on falling down. I mean, the sooner they do something with that, the better. But it's a sad state of affairs. If you look at that rink, if you compare it, I think it opened the same year as Swindon.
Yeah.
Look at Swindon, look at Basingstoke. Basingstoke's just about to fall down. Condemned on one side. Swindon, constant investment, always making the rink look better. I don't know. Hopefully Basingstoke gets some answers soon. It's been frustrating for the users group down there. It's frustrating for the town, really, because it's such an integral part for the kids to be able to, even if it's just go skating, figure skating, ice hockey, whatever it is. You've also then got, I don't know, probably 10 rec teams play out of Basingstoke. You got the ladies had to move to Slough because of ice time. And just, there's so much appetite for it around this area.
Yeah.
I think in a dream scenario, you put a twin ice pad in Basingstoke. We've got it in Sheffield. We've got one in Nottingham, obviously the arena, and then the small pad.
Yeah.
Cardiff and Basingstoke would be a great one. We're bang smack in the middle of the south. We're on the M3. We're on the M. We're not far from the M4, like 20 minutes from the M4. We're in that good window. We're 45, 50 minutes from London. You've got the catchment area of like down towards Southampton and Bournemouth because there's no rink that way. I if they were smart, that's what they would do, but we'll see.
I think it is going to be a twin pad going in at Lee Valley, isn't it, when that's finished?
Yep, and that'll be massive. I mean, you've got potential of, what, 9-10 million people live in London?
Yeah.
Well, let's get some of them. We don't need to get many of them interested in ice hockey, but if we can get a few that are fucking half good, then we could be onto something, because I can't remember the last time we heard of a player coming from, like, London. Like really coming from London and coming on and doing anything or being a national team, or there's not, you get occasional guy from Essex maybe, or do you know what I mean? Like around the area, but you never hear, like, I guess Malik Martelli.
Yeah.
He's gone on to MK. He's got the potential. He's a London boy, isn't he? Who's the other black kid that was in Streatham last year, then went to Romford? Harvey.
Oh, Briggs.
Yeah. He's not a bad little guy as well. He's a good little player. So there is potential. Now, if you think about that, and you can get twin ice pads rammoed, get these kids from Streatham and Romford and wherever else over for extra ice time as well. There's potential. Having two pads, just it's so much potential. The potential to be able to do hockey camps and clinics and coaching schools and all these kind of things is going to be massive. Obviously, Lee Valley are there's no way to sugarcoat it. They're dog shit, aren't they, really? At senior level, like I think they maybe won like 5 games in the last 5 years. So I think with a bit of if they're going to invest in the rink, it'd be good for them to kind of maybe try and invest in the team as well. Because yeah. I think
they've been nomads for a while, haven't they? So that kind of helps.
I feel harsh because the boys still turn up, they still put it in. But I mean, no one wants to go and watch a losing product. So if they can figure a way to turn it around, get some guys signed up there in the new facility, be competitive in that league, that's only going to be able to help them go out into the community, bring people in the doors to come and watch the games. Then they start their learn to skate program, learn to play program, and they build off the back of bringing these people in to watch the games. But if you're losing 10-1 every week, no one's coming to watch.
No. So when did you finish playing? What was the reason behind you finishing?
Obviously, I got a ban. I finished in 2014, and then I got a ban straight on the back of that. By UK Inter Open, got 8-year ban from them. So my last club was Guildford. We went out in the playoff semi-finals in my last year, which was shit. Like, we had such a good team, and then we just we choked on the Saturday, which was crap. I thought that was going to be the perfect swan song, because at that stage I'd already become a PT, so I decided I was going to take a year to kind of focus on my career, because like I said, from the age of 13 it was pretty much Monday to Sunday in an ice rink every day. And then once I got into the EPL and coaching the conference, it would be the same. I'd be coaching Bainstoke Juniors Monday, Wednesday, my EPL training Tuesday, Thursday, conference on a Friday night, game Saturday, Sunday. So I'd been doing that for about 10 years, and I hadn't really focused. I'd only ever done like odd jobs, you know what I mean? Worked at a boozer, drove a pub, drove a van, like forklift and all that sort of thing, back in the pub again for a bit of chefing or whatever. It was all just stuff to do alongside hockey. It was never like a career. And then in like 2013, I decided that was when I was going to become a PT. So I was like just about a year into growing my business by the end of that season. And I decided I was going to like focus on that. So I spoke to Paul Dixon, and like I remember I was walking around Morrison and spoke, and that was kind of the last time I spoke to anyone about playing that year. And that was, I think that was a week after the season. I kind of thought, fuck it. So I was going to Ibiza. I jumped on a little cycle of what I thought was Anavar, which is banned anyway. But it ended up being Winstrol. Basically, this was, I want to say it was like the 14th of June or something like that. They knocked on the door. My ex-missus at the time opened the door. You can't eat dope in. Hot piss test. I refused because I was like, well, season's done. I'm done. I'm not playing next year. So what right do you have? Like, at this point, bearing in mind, you've not been getting paid for like 2 and a bit months. So our season finished on that semi-final. This was 2 months later. So it's not going to enhance any fucking performances, that's for sure, seeing as there isn't any. It was literally just to drop a bit of fat, and it was naive probably on my part, but is what it is. But yeah, so I refused the test, and they came back about a week later, and I was like, fuck it, I'll do the test. Did the test, and they classed it as two separate violations. So when they came back the second time, I thought they were coming back just to test me because I refused the first time. It was all a bit snaky, but like the whole breakdown's out there. I did a podcast with Anthony Russell, Banners on the Wall, and we spoke in depth right at the very time when it was raw. And like, I mean, I don't want to say too much about UCAD, but they're a bit of a piss take. We'll come back on in April, and I'll tell you some more stories, but I've got a little saying going with them for now. So I need to be careful what I say. But
they're not doing themselves any favours in boxing or anything now, are they, at the moment? So,
like, once you've been involved with them and you see them from the inside and see what they're actually like, then, yeah, you can see they're not doing themselves any favours with boxing. It's just funny, the guys that they catch. Now, I've spoke about it on my podcast before. Like, how much fucking growth and tests and shit's AJ been on in his whole life? You don't just walk around at 18 stone jacks ripped year-round, like... Just the guys that you can see, obviously they caught Ben, didn't they?
Yeah.
But it wasn't actually them that caught them. It was, it was Wada. Like, they had the whole thing with Tyson Fury and his joke of a ban. And then we had Dillian White getting caught for blow, and then it was all right. They'll catch a fucking seventh league footballer or an EPL ice hockey guy or a amateur boxer or whatever, like an amateur rugby. Because what they do is they fill a quota. And you'll see that. Like, how's no one in the Premier League? Just law of averages. Let's say every squad has 25 guys and there's 20 teams in the Prem. That's 500 guys. You're telling me there's 500 guys in that league that don't do drugs?
Well, there was something recently about the Liverpool team and using inhalers.
Yeah, absolutely. Using an inhaler.
Yeah, the amount of people in the world that have got asthma, and then all of a sudden they reckon that everyone in the Liverpool squad has got asthma.
Well, it's just that little steroid inhaler. Opens out your airways. it's yeah, it works. Like in my day, it used to be Sudafed. Everyone used to pop little Sudis before the game, little red ones. And it's just a decongestant. I think actually they might have had a bit of ephedrine in as well, so they gave you a little fucking kick up the ass to get you going. But I mean, that was when you used to be allowed to drink like Jack 3D and that proper one. Fucking one of them pre-game, you know, just wired, ready to go. But yeah.
Obviously you got till April then, till that finishes with you.
No, it's already finished. It finished in June last year, but I can't really go into it, so I'll leave it for now. But we will definitely talk about it.
So obviously you finished playing, and then I think was it 2019 you started 4,000 and counting?
It was indeed, yeah. It's been going a while now. I think we're rolling into the fourth year just about.
What's the story about the team and why you wanted to start it?
So I came across Spitting Chicklets late. Well, I say late. Not as late as everyone else in the UK, but my brother had already been listening to it since like episode 4. When it was just Wit and RA on the couch, like shooting shit, and Biz was not even a thought. So I came into it a little bit later than that. Well, I'll tell you what it would have been. It would have been probably about 3 months before now, 4 years ago. And I started listening to it quite regularly. And I was always of the thing of, because I was there for a lot of the stories, and it was like, but prior to podcasts coming out and stuff, I was like, I always thought we had to just shut the fuck up. like what happened on that day stays on that day, and everybody stays married and it's all good. But it turns out you can have a bit of fun with it. And when I did the Banners on the Wall podcast, like I said, eight years ago, and I was like, I quite enjoyed it, and I quite liked the aspect of it, and I'd listened to a few of his, but podcasts weren't really big 8 years ago. Like it weren't really a thing. Even when we did it 4 years ago, I think it's something stupid. Like the year that we started doing it, there was something stupid, and this is all podcasts, like 500,000 podcasts in the world.
Yeah.
I believe this year it's rocked in at 4.5 million.
Yeah, it's so
like in the 4 years that we've been doing it, there's 4 million more podcasts, which is mental. I think it's really interesting. Like, it's interesting that everyone can just set up and go. And basically, our one started. I was listening to Chicklets, and I kind of put a little thing out on Facebook, and then Bandy jumped on, and he was like, "Oh, mate, thanks for the heads up. That's a laugh. Loved it. Whatever." And then, I think Mac had commented on it, and Arms had commented on it. And then a couple of weeks later, pissed up Bandy was like tweeted out at like 3 o'clock in the morning. He added us. So when are we starting this podcast then? I think we recorded the first episode the next day. We just went, because I wasn't too sure where I sat, because obviously my band and that, and I was still in the middle of my band. Could I do it? Could I not? And then I thought, you know what? Fuck it. Like, I'm not banned from doing a podcast.
No, I don't think there's many rules surrounding it, really. I mean, if you look at it's basically on-demand radio, isn't it, a podcast? But
essentially, yeah.
There's no rules on swearing or anything that you can put out there. You can use other people's music and not be copyright charged for it. It's a
good way of communicating, the long-form conversation. I think, especially with hockey players, because all you normally get is 35 seconds in between a period or at the end of a game, or you get a few words in the program where they've asked them who their favorite player or whatever it is. It's not a real conversation, and then you're not really getting to know anything about them or any stories from them. So the fact that we get to do the long form, I think it gets the players out there a little bit. I think we should be, why shouldn't we be trying to brand our players like everybody else? Why shouldn't they be able to get their names out there, promote themselves, maybe get some sponsorships on the side? Like, no one's making a lot of money at this. Let's try and help the boys out a bit.
Absolutely. I mean that was the only idea really behind me starting this, was to just try and push the game out there, because I came late to it just because I didn't know it was there.
Oh, really? So are you from Chelmsford?
From Colchester.
Oh, okay. And
I'm nearly 40 now. I got into ice hockey with the Mighty Ducks in the 90s. I saw the Leafs in Toronto in early 2000s. But I love sport. My wife says that I'll watch four nuns play badminton because it's sport.
I would.
But I had absolutely no idea that I could go and watch semi-pro ice hockey 20 minutes from my house.
Yeah, and they fell in love with it straight away then.
Yeah, I took my daughter. At the time, she was nearly 10 because it was before COVID. And straight away, we were like, yeah, we love this. And then obviously the COVID lockdown hit and everything sort of shut down. So we were waiting to get back. But, and I think that's the sort of, as we were talking earlier with ice time, the facilities that need upgrading, there's areas in the country that just need a facility.
Yeah.
The more we grow the game, the more that will happen. And I think the better the guys are doing at the international level, it's when they start qualifying for the Olympics and stuff, that's when they will get the recognition.
They had a great opportunity last year in Nottingham and choked at the last stage. And it's disappointing because I actually, leaning into that, I felt pretty confident that they were going to get the job done. I am, however, very, very confident they'll get the job done in Nottingham this time, and they will be one of the two teams that come out of that group 100%.
Yeah, I'm the same. And I think the women are doing a good job as well, and they'll represent.
Yeah. So, yeah, I've had Jodie and a couple of the other girls on, Saf and Nats and Ganny, and a few of the GB girls over the years have been on the podcast. And right behind the ladies, Emily Harris as well. She's out tearing it up in the NCAA. There's Casey Trails out there as well. There's a few girls abroad. Lucy Beals abroad doing bits, and the Headland sisters, they're out in the stateside as well. So there's quite a lot of GB girls representing across the world right now.
Yeah, I think I've had Sham Jackson on with me. She's over at OHA. She's looking to go NCAA. And I've got a few of the under-18s girls coming on in the next few weeks as well.
Yeah, nice, good.
They're doing really, really good things.
Love to see it.
You're with 4,000 and counting. You're over 200 episodes deep now in the 4 years.
Yeah.
Have you got a favourite?
Theo Fleury.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, anyone that grew up watching hockey when I watched, the fact that I got to sit and interview Theo Fleury was mad. And obviously we got to talk to him about everything. So from the sexual abuse from his coach, from his cocaine habit to blowing fucking $1 million contracts like they were going out of fashion. And he was so candid, so open and honest. So that was fun. Adam Greeno, when he got out of jail, oh, that was good. He told a story called the Cousin Vinny story. I won't put it on here just in case you got some kids listening. But if you
do normally keep it cleanish on here.
if you do want to go and listen to Adam Greener's episode 7, go listen to his Cousin Vinny story. It will make you laugh. Terry Miles is like king of impressions. So when he came on, that was a great crack. One from the old school, Paul Heavey. He made me cry laughing during that podcast, honestly, because the old school guys don't give a shit.
No, they don't.
They don't care. So he came out and just told all the stories. Whereas you've got the young guys going, oh, I better not say this, I'll get him in trouble. I better not. Heaves just came straight in. It was like, yeah, one night we were down here and then we were driving the team car. We jumped out, let the team car go down the hill, and just all the stories. Telling stories about one of the imports was one of the, I think it was a Ukrainian guy, said it was his last night he was going, so they all went to have beers at the house, and they were sponsored by Labatt. So he said just cases and cases and cases of Labatt in the team house, and one of the Polish lads finishes his beer, stands up and chucks it off the wall, and the boy's like, what are you doing? He's like, tradition, he said. So after that, every beer they drank, everybody was just turning around. So you walk into the living room of this team house, and it's just like a wall of glass just built
glass.
So they're thinking it's December, they go, oh, it's a bit cold, we get a fire going. So they're outside and they've got nothing to get it going, so they're grabbing books off the bookshelf, starting this fire in the garden, and then they're upstairs breaking matey's bed and desk and drawers and that. Everything's going on the fire. He's going home, he's going back to Poland or Ukraine, wherever he was from. So those old school guys, they're fun to interview. They got stories for days. And then more serious one, getting to interview Colin Shields twice, that was cool. The second time more so, because the first time we interviewed him was our first interview, so it was a little bit raw. The second time, I think it was 100 and something episodes in. But I've it started myself, Bandy, Mac, and then Mark joined a little later, but I haven't actually missed a single episode. So rocking and raring to go. We've got more lined up, and yeah, as quick as our producer can get them out, I'll keep recording them.
Yeah, and I mean, people that do, as you said, there's so many people that have sort of popped up and doing them, and now just aware of how time consuming it is.
Oh yeah. it's very time consuming. It takes up a lot of time, especially now we're moving into the YouTube side of things. So how we used to do things before, we come on and we would do like our talk about what's current, what's going on UK hockey, GB hockey, Liam Kirk abroad, whatever it may be, and then we would do our interview and then wrap up, whereas now we're going to do all our interviews are still going to remain on like Buzzsprout, Spotify, podcasts, wherever you find your podcasts, etc. But our kind of current affairs or more kind of opinion based stuff around the UK game is going to move to our YouTube channel. Right. I just think it just kind of covers more bases. And I know from speaking to a couple of the boys, they like this kind of thing where they're watching. And I was like, well, I don't mind being on camera. So you get used to it, right? You get used to being on camera, same as anything else. And
yeah,
I think it's a good avenue to grow. All of a sudden, we just had an influx of subscribers with our new content that's gone out, which is good. Try to get to that magical 1,000 so we can start monetizing it. That's obviously the plan. And yeah, continue to grow. Obviously, throughout the podcast, we've been able to do some cool stuff. We've been to a couple of Challenge Cup finals, interviewed some of the guys on the ice afterwards. Been to the World Champs out in Slovakia, which was good. And then we've hit some different spots across the UK with the podcast as well, which has been fantastic.
Did you have your own charity game as well? I see a picture of you and Mac wearing jerseys.
Yeah. We've had a couple of charity games. We were due to have another, but obviously COVID kiboshed that, which was annoying because, I don't know, fucking weeks of planning went into that. Weeks and weeks and weeks, and then COVID kicked it on the ass. Obviously, try to like message 50 guys. That year, we was having girls and junior showcase, all of it going on in one day. Yeah, to have the rug pulled, that was very frustrating. But yeah, we've done loads of stuff for charity, and not only the charity games, we've done like Christmas toy drives, and I'm just trying to think. One of the girls got cancer, dyed our hair, just stupid stuff, really, whatever we could do to raise money. We did the buckets for Bowers when Ross Bowers lost his eye. I think that ended up, and we like liaised with teams to get collections and go, and that got over like £35,000. We started a GoFundMe and like promoted a GoFundMe for Ollie Pyatt, for Andre's boy when Andre died.
Yeah,
I think that was like 9,000 maybe at the end. Like, there's been a few things. I think out and out since we started, kind of all in, about 85,000 pounds been raised for charity of some way, description or another, throughout the charity games and GoFundMes and shirt auctions and other shit that we've done. So we've been quite fortunate on that sense to be able to do that. I think actually one of the best things we got to do, one of the little lads we know Zooms, or Zach to everybody else, he got leukemia. So the first year that we did the charity game, money went, some of the money went to Royal Marsden, it went to a couple of other places, and then some of the money went to the family direct, which I thought was good. That was part of the reason like we wanted to do it, raise some money for them, obviously, spending all that time up at Royal Marsden. We got to then take Zach up to Scotland. He got to read out we gave him like the arena tour of the clan. Like, it was a surprise. He didn't know me and Bandy were going to be there. So we arranged it all with like Fitzy and Ryan Finity. He got to go in the locker rooms of the clan, of the Storm. We got to read out the starting lineups and all that kind of stuff. And then like do the puck drop. And then he was like up leading the drums, and then he was with Klangus, the mascot, and then at the end he got to like lead the Viking clap with Springer, so it's where they give it the So yeah, like, it was just a wicked day, honestly. It was probably the best thing we've done since being a part of this podcast. He's only 5 or 6 at the time. He had the time of his life, so it was awesome.
Yeah, well, for the other British hockey podcasts that are out there, I mean, there isn't really that many that are made in Britain, but the obviously, you've got yourselves. I think Blackburn Hawks have got one. The British Ice Hockey Podcast as well. And the 3-on-3 guys that run the Elite League.
Yeah.
Stuff, they talk about that. And it's all good for growing the game. And with you guys obviously being all ex-players, it's a really, really good insight.
Yeah, I know. It just helps that I'm friends with so many people in this game and so many contacts that I could just pull people. That's how I've been lucky enough to get the guests on that I've had on. And the ones that are lined up coming like throughout the end of the season into the World Champs and then into the off season, it's only going to continue to be bigger. Got big aspirations for this podcast. And it's but now that it's on YouTube, I think it's just going to start flying.
Brilliant, mate. Well, good luck to you for the rest of it. I really enjoy listening to 4,000 Counting. It's
I love it.
One of my runs that I have on in the van when I'm out and about. So, I appreciate your time joining me today and coming on here. It's a little cross promotion so that we can, you know, sort of share with your listeners.
When I spoke to you before, like, that's what it's about. There isn't that many UK podcasts, and there's no reason that it should be anything else than like try to help each other out, because if we can grow our podcast, we can grow the game. We can, because I mean, I just know from the amount of people that reach out, especially players, when we talk about certain subjects, and they appreciate having someone that can go out in the public domain and say some of the shit that they probably can't. And having that kind of relationship with myself, I don't mind. I'll put my colours out there. I'm not afraid to speak my mind and have an opinion on stuff, which is probably why people still tune in, I guess.
Yeah, there's no better carrot than controversy, is there?
Well, absolutely. I mean, this year there hasn't really been too much controversy. Like the reason our Facebook page like grew astronomical was because there was like a 2-year stint where something crazy happened every week. We shared the video and everyone's just like getting involved, having comments, and then it just helps the page grow. And I think we're like, I don't know, 5,700 followers or something on there. But like what we want to do, we want to be trying to push like the 1,500 every week downloads on this, and then just see where we go with the YouTube and just try and grow the pod, grow the game, and keep having fun with it, because it's supposed to be fun, right? And I love doing it.
Yeah, that's the only reason I do it. It's a bit of fun. It gets the details out from everything that goes on with the Chieftains and the Chieftains fans. And I'm enjoying, as we spoke about, you know, a few months ago, growing it and having people from other teams or GB or, you know, other podcasts and that, just to get more out there about the game. I joined the guys from 3-on-3 this week. I think that'll be coming out in a couple of weeks.
I think I'm joining them at some point in the next couple of weeks here, actually.
Yeah, great guys. Really good chat. I think we was on there for hours. I don't know how much is going to come out, but
well, see what they get to the editing floor, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Nicky Watt, thank you so much for joining me on Zero Pucks Given.
Well, mate,
good luck with everything for 4,000
Counts. Great name for the podcast, by the way. Thanks for having me, bud.
Nice one. Cheers, bud.
All right, all the best, buddy. Cheers.
A huge thank you to Nicky Watt. Again, isn't it just so interesting to hear these sort of inside hockey stories? That's basically what 4,000 and Counting is all about. So if you do like your cheeky stories from inside the world of hockey, then it's a great podcast to check out. So just before we get to our final guest of the day, we are going to do Hit of the Week. Hit. Hit of the week this week, then, it goes to Ross Clark, as in the second period, as the Chieftains were trying to push the MK Thunder back to try and get even more goals on the tally. I didn't get the name, but it was Milton Keynes, number 52, who was just coming past the benches until Ross Clark come flying in, benched him. Hit of the week, Ross Clark. Hit. Hit of the week for Ross Clark there. Better that he's getting the hit of the week than being on the receiving end of it from Rainer, I suppose. So now our final guest of this episode. Do you know who he is? He's Richie Pickering.
Chieftains. Number 50.
Rapper Kenny. Kenny Hop. I spit it through the wire, man.
Richie Pickering, how are you doing, fella?
Yeah, I'm good, thank you. You?
Yeah, mate, really good. Thanks for joining me on Zero Pucks Given. Big win at the weekend. What's your thoughts?
Yeah, it was good. I think we needed it. It was, it was a fun, just nice, easy game. Yeah, it was good fun.
Are they really short on numbers? Because they've been getting tonked on a regular, haven't they?
To be honest, I don't really pay much attention to the other teams. I should do, but yeah, I don't think they're the best of the teams in the league. I'm not sure what the other results have been. But they beat us early on in the season, didn't they?
They did, yeah. I think it was 4-2, I think, earlier in the year. And it was,
yeah.
From what I heard, they had a few rec players playing in their team as well. It wasn't by any means their first sort of available set. Yeah, they beat us at the Riverside. But I think they have lost Tom Carlin and lost a couple of their sort of better players that have stepped up to the National League. So,
yeah.
But yeah, they have been getting tonked on the regular. So it's just hope they survive. We don't need any more teams dropping out of the league.
Yeah, no, that's not fun.
But yes, it's 14-1, and you got one of the goals.
Yep, my first goal for the Chieftains.
Yeah, not your normal style, though, is it? Because normally you like a bit of a slap shot from the blue line.
Yeah, well, I wouldn't say much of a slap shot. They normally topple in, don't they?
So, yeah, tell us about the goal.
Yeah, just to be fair, I don't know what I was doing that down low. I'm never normally down low like that. Just popped out in front, and I was just had a little shot and hope for the best when I let go of it.
Yeah, it was just in the slot all by yourself. You probably stood there with the puck at the end of your stick going, what?
Where's everyone? I nearly had a nosebleed being that low down.
But you tucked it away quite well, actually. It was a nice finish.
Oh, thank you.
It was a nice finish. So, have you enjoyed the step up from the Warriors to the Chieftains? Was it something you felt you needed?
Yeah, 100%. I've always wanted to do it, but I never really wanted the commitment. Like, obviously, with work and things like that, like, it's a lot more than like the Warriors League, obviously. Most weekends they only have one game, whereas with the Chieftains we have games virtually every week, if not one, two. So, yeah, that was a lot of it, the commitment. Obviously, I haven't played hockey as long as like most of the lads that have played in that league. So, yeah, I'm glad I took the step up. I'm enjoying it. Yeah, it's good.
That's good. So when did you start then? And have you always been Chelmsford-based? Did you come right through the ranks then?
No, I was a Romford junior. So I started when I was about, I'm pretty sure it was under 10s or under 12s. And then I played for about 4 years until it was under, I think it was different back then. I think it was under 12s, then under 15s. I can't quite remember. But I played up until I was about 14, 15. And then obviously they shut Run Valley Way. And then I stopped playing. So I'd only played about 4 or 5 years of actual hockey. And then, yeah, I was just played football, just done other bits, really.
So you had that time off after Ron Valley shut, and then did you end up down at Chelmsford?
No, so I didn't play for a good 7-8 years I didn't play for, maybe longer. And then they opened up the new ice rink.
Yeah.
And I went out with a couple of the rec teams, done a bit of that, and then I went down to Lee Valley. I done a season with Lee Valley. That was more like a Milton Keynes team. They getting pumped every week, but it was good to get back into like league hockey. And then following year, Warriors, and then this year Warriors and Chieftains. So
yeah,
it's only been 3 seasons I've actually been back into the role of it like quite properly.
Yeah. It's not like it shows or anything, mate. I think it doesn't look like you've been away from the sport. It looks like you've been playing it for a long time. You know, you're fairly... that step up. I don't get to see the Warriors as much as I would like, but
yeah,
it was clear at that level that you could be one of those that could make that step up a league level. And I think you slotted in really well. You're a big physical guy. I think you've done really well since you've come up.
Yeah, thank you.
So at the moment, you're wearing one of the spare jerseys, wearing number 50. Is that your chocolate number? Or would you...
No, just 25 is my number, really.
Yeah.
No particular reason, just... My birthday's the 5th of Feb, so I reckon 5th of the 2nd, 2-5, but not that it... I just think it's a nice number, to be fair.
Yeah, but you have to stick with one of the spare ones for
yeah, well, hopefully if Alana and that get it sorted, I'll have one soon.
So you were a Romford lad and then playing through Romford. Were you a Raiders fan as a lad? Did you go and watch it recreationally?
Yeah, I used to go and watch my dad, like with my dad and my brother. We used to go and watch the Raiders play pretty much every week. Like, I remember watching Turner. I used to watch Jules play. All of them, really. Yeah, it's good to be playing with them as well.
Yeah. So did your dad play or did your brothers play?
No, it was just... ended up going skating once, loved it. Become a half decent skater, and then I've always been fairly big for my age, and then one of my mates was like, oh, do you fancy playing hockey? And I was like, yeah, go on then. So I'd give it a go. I'd done the learn to play. And then, yeah, I started in the under-12s, I think it was.
Yeah.
And just went on from there.
How did the learn to play go at Romford then? How did that work? Was it like a gradual build-up between...
Yeah, so you had like three groups. So it was obviously like beginners and then group two and then group three. So it was like three groups. And then you obviously progress into... And then once you're in group three, they sort of try and filter you into the teams.
Yeah.
But I think... And
when you do the learn to plays, because it's something I'm really interested in, because I think it's one of the barriers in the sport of getting new people into it, is that it's so expensive to start playing.
Yeah, that is also why, like, obviously I didn't carry on playing. Obviously it would have cost mum a lot of money to get me to and from Chelmsford every week or up to Lee Valley. So that was like a massive part of it, as well as like, because I think hockey is like, it is like part of, like, skate sticks, everything. It's just like mega money. It's a shame, to be fair, because I think if it was a lot cheaper, you could get a lot more kids involved. But yeah, I think then there isn't much funding. Like, you look at how many football pitches there are over a park, or
yeah,
like, you can't just put a pair of skates on or whatever.
Nah, and play. We don't really have the weather here, do we? To have
exactly,
so yeah. Obviously, we have discussed quite a few times today. There's one in the Peterborough way, isn't there? They flood a field,
and they've got
Shinny on the field. I think, yeah, Pence told us about it. Leo Markey sent me a picture of him playing on it when he was about 10.
Yeah.
So, you know, I don't think we've got anything like that in Essex, actually, which is a
proper shame.
But, I think that's a constant battle with it, is facilities. You know, just for lack of numbers. I think it's 26 ice rinks in England, or possibly even the whole UK.
Yeah, it's crazy.
And, yeah, I mean, there's 26 football pitches in this town.
Yeah, that's probably double that.
Yeah, it's mental. So it's, yeah, I understand that it's obviously that. I think once they do break that barrier down, it will start to become, because I think the sport is growing. I think it's growing
massively,
in this country, and it's grown for years.
Yeah.
But it's just going to be breaking that barrier down. It's something I spoke with some of the women's coaches and Alan Blythe, the youth academy coach.
Yeah.
With the equipment, you know, there's got to be something, as you said, funding.
Yeah.
So that every club maybe has, you know, five sets of kit,
yeah,
people to use. And then, yes, if they get into it, they like it and they're good.
I see a puck stop do a thing with, like, the goalie equipment, don't they? I think, obviously, because goalie equipment...
Yeah, it's like a sponsorship thing, isn't it? With
the
goalies, and they'll kit them out.
Yeah, I think if the kids want to be a goalie or whatever, they can rent it from them or whatever.
Yeah, because that's mega money, isn't it?
Yeah.
You want to be a goalie. Remember Luca telling me that he was a player...
Yeah.
And then sort of he had all the gear and then said to his dad, actually I want to be a goalie. So then he's like the pads and the blocker and the oh, so much money.
Yeah, I bet Fab wasn't happy when he said that.
No, probably not. Have you ever played any other sports?
Yeah, I played football at quite a good standard. I played for Redbridge. That was good. I used to go out on my bike a lot. I've always been very active.
You got someone calling you.
I've never been someone just to sit indoors or whatever. I've always been out playing football or cricket, you name it, I've probably done it, tennis.
That's proper hand-eye coordination, the old tennis.
Yeah, I'm not that good at it, but I'll have a go.
That's the main thing for a lot of sports. If you just have a go...
Exactly,
You don't know, you might be half decent at it.
Yeah, exactly.
We've got quite a few questions that come in from some of the listeners, some of the fans, and of course some of your teammates.
Yeah.
And some of these they're quite good, actually. We start with Ollie Bennett. He's asked, if you could have a superpower, what would it be and what would you use it for?
Superpower? God. I don't know. Probably a fly.
Yeah. Get places a lot quicker.
Yeah, do what you want, couldn't you? If you could fly, you could go where what you want, do what you want. No one ever catch you doing anything.
The invisibility would be a good one for that.
Yeah.
You get away with a lot doing that. Lily C. Wade has asked, I think we've already covered actually, how long you've been playing. So you were like 10 when you
first... Yeah, about 10, 11, yeah, I think, I'm pretty sure. I'd skated, like, before that, so I'd skated for a good few years, like, used to go down. I used to be down Romford Ice Rink every Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Like, mum used to drop me off and then come back and get me. And I've been skating for hours and hours. And then, yeah, and then I've become a decent skater and then went into hockey.
Yeah, which I've spoke with a few of the other lads. That's almost like it's definitely the first step. And once you've mastered that skating, you can kind of forget about that and concentrate on your hands.
Yeah, I think it is. I think skating's a massive part of it. Like, I think more so than, obviously, like, your stick work. Obviously, that comes hand in hand.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, you can play.
Yeah, but if you're not, like I say, if you're not proficient at the skating, you'll get found out, wouldn't you, as you go up the levels, if you with the speed and the change of direction and...
Yeah, 100%. That's what, like, I find it now sometimes, like, obviously when we're playing, like, the bigger teams, like, a lot more experienced players, and, like, it's hard to read them. Like, you obviously, like, the likes of, like, when I'm playing with Dan or you got Ethan, like, you look how calm Ethan is on the puck, like, you'll notice it compared to me. Like, obviously, I've played in the lower leagues. It's a lot scrappier. It's a lot of dish the puck out, whereas Ethan will take his time. But, obviously, that comes with time with me. So,
yeah, it does,
playing
yeah.
the league and...
Yeah, it all comes with time and experience, yeah. doesn't it? So, I'd say Daisy's one I'm going to save for a minute because it will actually link into a few of the other ones that I've got. Sophia, the sign girl, has asked if you've ever done skiing or snowboarding and where's your favourite destination?
No, I've never skied and I've never snowboarded.
Is that a winter sport that's got any interest to you?
Yeah, I would love to, actually. I'd love to go skiing. I think I'd be half decent in it. But yeah. I think most hockey players would say that.
Yeah, I would imagine so, actually. Yeah, just the proficiency with the cold, for one.
Yeah. My favourite place. I went on a holiday to Antigua when I was fairly a lot younger. My uncle got married out there. I think that's been that was beautiful. That was a lovely place. Yeah.
And absolutely no skiing or snowboarding out there.
No, definitely not. 35 degrees heat and beaches, that's a bit of me, that is.
Beautiful. Charlie has asked, she's asked, if you couldn't play hockey, what sport would you play?
Football, definitely.
Yeah. Definitely, sort of, yeah.
Yeah, I still play, like, Monday nights just with my mates. So I still get a bit of footballing now, yeah.
Do you not get the ache? Like, you get training on a Tuesday and you're, like, in the backs of your hammies and it's like, oh...
Yeah or no, but it's a nice ache, like, it's, I don't know, I do get it, but you're so used to just doing it, you don't, I feel like I get it, but I don't, like, if you know what I mean.
Yeah,
I don't
yeah.
feel it as much as, I know it's there. The worst ones, I'd say, is Friday, after we trained on a Thursday.
Because you put it, Monday night football, Tuesday night training, Thursday night training, then Friday morning.
Yeah, Friday morning, it's a bit of a, you wake up and you're like, oh.
God, I mean, I'm an old man now. I'm like pushing 40, and I've not played football for a long time because I did my knee. But
yeah,
God, I mean, if I played now, if just like a five a side on a Monday night with some, you know, 40-year-old fellas, I can't walk for 3 days. it's completely different.
No, I enjoy it. I think it's good for the like fitness as well. Like, it helps me out a little bit. I'm not the fittest of players, I'd say.
Do you like the gym as well, or is it some place that you avoid?
To be honest, yeah, I avoid it at all costs. I'm not a gym bod at all.
Nah, don't get too close to Callum Burnett.
No,
if,
I don't.
If he's dragging you there by the head.
He loves the gym, bless him.
So, what Daisy's asked is, have the guys got a nickname for you?
What, Ronnie?
This is the thing, the questions that are coming in from your teammates.
Yeah, a few of them, Ronnie. Not really. I'd say Ronnie mostly.
Yeah.
It's normally just, do you know who I am? But other than that, no, not really.
No, so yeah, just sort of stick with Ronnie.
Yeah.
So Rainer's asked, have you still got your red Citroen Zara Picasso?
I have, yeah. I was telling him he can borrow it after writing his car off.
Has he written his car off, has he?
No, I don't know. You have to ask him.
No, I think I did see a picture of his motor broken down on the side of the road, but... And Matty Turner's asked, have you calmed down yet after yelling at the bloke on the moped?
Yeah, I have, yeah. They do take liberties after moped drivers.
Yeah. And Hitch is just, he wants us all to ask, do we know who you are?
Everyone knows who I am, Ronnie Pickering.
So anyone listening or watching who doesn't know what we're going on about, if you put Ronnie Pickering into YouTube, just watch that and enjoy it because it's full-on British classic.
And so, I'm not related to him, but it's just to clarify that.
Yeah. Lovely, mate. Right, we've got a few Chiefs briefs to do with you.
Yep.
And I've had some help actually from Charlie. She's given me a few new ones. So you've got mainly new ones.
Yeah.
Nice and quick, just an either or, and then give your answer from that. So modern or retro?
Modern.
Swimming or running?
Running.
Ronnie or Richie?
Richie.
McDonald's or Burger King?
McDonald's.
Ducks or hawks?
Hawks.
Cam or Graham?
Oh, I don't know.
Black or gold?
To be fair, I can hardly tell them apart still. Gold.
I've just about got there now, I think, with that. Car or motorbike?
Car.
Leonardo DiCaprio or Leonardo da Vinci?
Caprio.
Mission Impossible or Bond?
Bond.
Excellent stuff, mate. Fantastic. Well, hopefully then, you know, people that don't see the Warriors often and have seen you step up to the Chieftains now know a little bit more about you.
Yeah.
Instead of and now knowing that you're wearing the spare jersey 50, but if 25 ever pops up, we'll know exactly who it is.
Yeah, hopefully. I'll get them. I ain't having Ronnie on it, but Pickering will definitely be on it.
Yeah. Excellent stuff. Richie Pickering, thanks for joining me, mate. Good luck for the rest of the season. And see you Saturday night at the home game for Slough.
Yeah, thank you, mate. Thanks for having me on. It was awesome.
A massive thank you to Richie Pickering for joining me on the podcast. And thank you to my other guests that have joined in this episode. Of course, Sam Callahan and 4000 Counting host Nicky Watt. Really great for you all coming on. I really do appreciate your time. Fixtures for the coming weekend. Chelmsford Chieftains are at home on Saturday 25th of February to the Slough Jets. Don't forget, they'll be doing some filming there for James Ayling and Frankie Sabini's film, The Enforcer. So stick around after the game if you want to get involved in that. Sunday, February 26th, Chelmsford Chieftains are travelling down to Invicta Dynamos in the league, the final dress rehearsal for the cup final at the end of March. And also on that Sunday, February 26th, the Chelmsford Cobras are at home to the Slough Ice Bees. So some free entry hockey at the Riverside if you're not travelling to Kent with the Chieftains. So episode 19 is in the bank. Thank you so much again to all my guests for joining me. Thank you to you guys for listening. Do everything you do with the sharing on social media and the word of mouth. I really, really do appreciate it. So we'll see you next week. Next week, I will have a representative from For Louis charity. Obviously, we're doing the game against Slough is raising funds and awareness for that charity. So I'll have a representative from them on next week to discuss how they did. And I've also got a couple of special guests next week. I've got former British player who's now coaching in America, Sam Chima. And I also have Abby Minter, Great Britain under-18s player. So we'll see you for that episode next week. Cheers, guys. This podcast is hosted by Anchor on Spotify. It is available on Spotify, Apple Podcasts and other podcast outlets. Subscribe on Spotify and Apple Podcasts to get notifications about new episodes. Follow us on social media, Instagram at Zero Pucks Given Podcast, Twitter at Zero Pucks Pod, YouTube at Zero Pucks Given, email zeropucksgivenpodcast@gmail.com. The music in this podcast is taken from Spotify and I do not own the tracks. Thanks for listening and we'll see you next time.